Hello, my name is Vesa Juvonen and I'm a principal consultant in Microsoft Corporation. In this demonstration, we will have a closer look on the SharePoint 2013 app model from a higher perspective. Why is it actually introduced? Where is it coming from? Is it actually beneficial? And is it really the future of SharePoint from a development and from an end user perspective? Before we actually go to the, let's say, conclusions and challenges with the old models or previous model, let's actually have a look back on the SharePoint the introduction of the SharePoint 2013 app model and why was it actually introduced in first place. So as part of the beta 2 release funds, we released a SharePoint blog post related on the new capabilities of SharePoint 2013. And one of the things which caused a lot of the discussions during with the community was the statement that use SharePoint as out-of-the-box application whenever possible. And this was a recommendation written by, well, the blog post was written by Jeff Tepper, and this was a recommendation as part of that blog post. And obviously that caused a lot of the kind of discussions in the community and in the field related on the future of the SharePoint and will it be still a development platform and how we should be approaching SharePoint. Because even when you think of it, since 2007 SharePoint, we've been using the SharePoint as a hardcore development platform, introducing custom features and solutions. And then in SharePoint 2010, we introduced the sandbox solutions, the kind of a slightly, let's say, reduce the risk of those deployments in a server farm level, but that wasn't that successful as well. But we've been teaching developers and architects to consider SharePoint as a development platform, and then suddenly as part of the beta 2 release cycles, this kind of a statement was actually given. So let's actually analyze that slightly, and let's actually have a look on that from a let's say, two steps back. So when did we actually say that SharePoint should be used as out-of-the-box application whenever possible? So what does actually our customers usually want, or why do they actually want customizations? Well, pretty often they want to have the UI changed based on their brand. So that's number one kind of a customization need. So at least the site logo or some of the coloring within the site or font should be changed based on the company brand. And this seems to be a really common approach. It really doesn't matter how big or small the customer is. The secondary thing is quite often that the business wants something cool or advanced, something which is not natively within a SharePoint, but we kind of taught people how to do and customize and extend the SharePoint. So therefore, people kind of have this assumption or thinking with SharePoint that let's just add additional capabilities which are not available there by default. And this is completely fine approach. This is just essentially the approach what we've been having in the past as well. So, but then when we start kind of opening up this approach, let's actually open up this from an upgrade perspective. So what does the customer actually want to upgrade to the latest versions of the SharePoint? Let's say from upgrading from SharePoint 2010 to SharePoint 2013. And it's actually kind of ironic. It's still the same statement. Well, it's not just something cool or advanced. They want to have those advanced new capabilities and functionalities which the new version is bringing. There's really nice new capabilities related on many of the stuff in 2013 compared to the 2010. So customers want to take advantage of those new capabilities as fast as possible. But then when we start analyzing what's actually keeping the customers for upgrading on that latest version, because when you think of it, the SharePoint natively out of the box, if there wouldn't be any content, if there wouldn't be any sites, if there wouldn't be any customizations, you can actually upgrade the SharePoint extremely seamlessly and fast. So that won't be an issue. But at the same time, many of the customers are hesitant to actually start these upgrade projects because they have these customizations. And the number one upgrade blocker is then this small deployment-specific customizations, because when you think of it, if the SharePoint site is out-of-the-box SharePoint site, let's say for collaboration. Collaboration is a tool. Collaboration sites is essentially a tool, almost similar tool as Microsoft Word or Outlook. But quite often we have introduced some new capabilities on top of that site. And those are actually the ones which are quite often blocking the upgrade to the latest version, which is kind of a nasty thing, because obviously if we would have considered the collaboration sites as a tool like Outlook, then there wouldn't be any need to really customize that. We don't do branding, we don't brand Outlook. Technically it's not actually even possible, but we don't actually want to brand the Outlook. People use the Outlook and it's blue and it's one of, well, using whatever color scheme. But still, it's not branded based on the company brands, because that's tool. And the same applies for the collaboration sites, or that would be an awesome approach. Obviously, the intranet or internet-facing sites, that's the situation is slightly different. But coming back on the customization and these deployment-specific customizations, what the customers and end users are actually using, those are usually the ones which are blocking the upgrade. As an example, we have created a custom master page for SharePoint 2010, and we cannot upgrade directly to SharePoint 2013 because custom master pages created for SharePoint 2010 do not work as such in the SharePoint 2013, because the styling, the CSS, the HTML formatting has been changed dramatically for better, because now we as an example, the web part zones are not tables, and there's a really good amount of fixing. But at the same time, that is blocking then the usage of the existing custom master pages in 2013. But let's analyze this further slightly more. So what's the number one reason for support cases in SharePoint? This is not a official thing, but it's quite close, actually. I haven't done the real metrics, but still, if it's not the number one, it's really, really quite often the number one reason for opening the Premier support case or a general bug report. It's, again, those deployment-specific customizations. And to be honest, quite often it's those cool and advanced widgets, which weren't actually required in first place, but somebody from business or somebody from corporate communications wanted to have this really cool, fancy widget, which is blinking on the front page of the internet. And now that widget is now essentially blocking the upgrade or getting hands on the new and better capabilities. What's the number one cost factor in projects? It's not actually the SharePoint licenses. Well, it depends again on the project and the project size and the company size and how much people actually do stuff. But if you think about enterprise projects where we build a global intranet or global collaboration platform, it is actually the costs are related on those deployment specific customizations, which again might be those cool and advanced widgets. It's not necessarily building the first initial customization. It's also maintaining that. And also the fact that it's actually blocking us to move to the newer version of SharePoint 20, like the SharePoint 2013. Just for the sake that nobody knows, is it actually working with the latest version? And it might be a critical functionality for our customization. And that has massive impact on the life cycle of the deployment and life cycle of SharePoint within the customer premises. So kind of a conclusion out of this all, when you think of it, all of that previous things, is that, to be honest, all customizations are evil. It's a really strong statement, I know, but essentially let's quickly open that one up. It blocks upgrade the newer version. If you wouldn't have any customizations, the newer versions and new capabilities, which would be natively introduced against on top of the out-of-the-box or old master pages and so forth, would be, again, available without any additional things. Those customizations, they cause additional costs for customers, and quite often people are, moving from 2007 to 2010, we've seen even from 2003, customers have been doing these upgrade projects, and those are pretty expensive actually, or they might be, slightly depends again on the customization scale. And essentially what the customer extensions are then doing, they are blocking access to that new and shiny things, which is kind of an ironic because the customizations are built to provide new and shiny things which were not available originally, as an example in SharePoint 2010. So we built these new and shiny things as a development specific customizations, but then whenever the newer version of the SharePoint comes to be available, those are the same things which are actually blocking the access of those new and shiny things which would be now out of the box natively available within your SharePoint. And that's actually what the statement was all about. So whenever we start planning and doing these customizations, regardless if you are a customer or a developer or an architect, we need to actually understand the implications. Because if we always use SharePoint as out of the box whenever possible, that minimizes the customizations, which minimizes access on the new and shiny versions and functionalities, whatever we are introducing. At the same time, it reduces the costs related on life cycle of the SharePoint. Does it mean that we shouldn't be customized? No, it doesn't mean that. SharePoint is still a platform where we can introduce new capabilities and new functionalities. That's still the case. But it means that the approach, when you think of it, it's a voice of reasoning, which is saying that, yeah, well, minimize customizations, the less it will cost you, like we actually show from the from the previous slides. Now, one of the key objectives of this one is that obviously we want to provide the newest capabilities without any delays. And one of the key changes what we're seeing now within the cloud services and also actually in the future in the on-premises side is that the release cycle is getting shorter and shorter with SharePoint. This has been introduced and said by Jeff Thieper as an example in the SharePoint conferences and a few other times. So we want to have still the end users and customers able to take the latest versions of SharePoint into a use without additional costs related on the customizations or minimizing the costs or during this upgrade. So that's our objective. Because customers, quite often, the enterprise customers, we're hearing the pain, we're hearing that feedback that if we start releasing a newer version of SharePoint in every single year, nobody's willing to do a 8 months or 6 months upgrade project between the versions, and which might cost a humongous amount of money. If we can minimize that required changes every single time there's a new version coming, also in product, but also in customizations, we can actually provide new functionalities for the end users and the customers and business in a much faster way. And we're seeing this quite nicely in Office 365 as well, related on SharePoint 2013 services, because we're seeing all the time new capabilities being introduced, and the cycle is getting smaller and smaller. And that will happen also in the on-premises side. But at the same time, we need to remember that the customers and partners need to be able to customize and modify SharePoint experience. So this is definitely a requirement, and this will be something which we need to tackle in the future as well, regardless on the fact that we need to minimize at the same time the impact of these customizations. And the whole point of this transition to this SharePoint app and the cloud application pattern is actually the fact that the business is not going away. The customization business and the modification of the SharePoint experience based on the business requirements after analyzing is it actually required or not and is it feasible or not based on the costs. That business is not going away. We still want SharePoint to be customized in a way that is beneficial for all of the parties. The ones who are providing the SharePoint, the ID administrators, so that we don't compromise the quality of the service, like the Office 365, or the on-premises service provider, like your IT organization. But at the same time, we want to have that flexibility for the business to be able to introduce new widgets, new functionalities, whatever they're looking for, using that awesome SharePoint platform. And this is actually a kind of a really difficult challenge, which we are in a journey to tackle with the SharePoint app and the cloud application model. And the reasoning, we've been talking about the reasoning already a few times, but the impact of the customizations is so dramatical within a SharePoint. So we need to actually understand that every single time we introduce a custom web board or we introduce some new template, a web template to be available within the farm. From a development perspective, that could be a really easily doable. Personally, I love web templates, and I can create a new custom web template in a matter of minutes. But the impact of that web template in the short and the long term could be much more bigger than the time that I'm actually using on creating the customization. So as an example, we need to think about the fact that there are maintenance and operational costs related on the customization approach. And this really, really well, good example of this one is the fact that whenever you deploy a full trust solution, if we take the old path and we deploy these full trust solutions using, let's say, full trust solutions for deploying master pages and page layouts and web parts and whatever, every time we need to do a small change or every time we need to maintain or update that existing deployment, there will be a service break. And quite often, actually, customers, the business owners of the service, they don't like their intranet to be away, even though it would be a Sunday afternoon. Or if it's an internet-facing site, well, we need to remember that the internet is kind of a, there's no weekends or weekdays. It has to be up and running 24/7. So you can't really, you need to minimize that downtime impact of these customizations. And choosing the right path has a massive impact on this one. Quite often people don't realize the long-term impact of the availability and to the operations and maintenance costs as well. The impact of the customizations and the approach obviously affects on the agility on deploying new functionalities and widgets. When I think the old pattern using the full trust code, quite often, especially in bigger enterprises, there was a massive, let's say, weeks and weeks long quality assurance periods where all of the change, whatever changes we were introducing, we were forced to wait until we get that functionality to be available. This obviously depends highly on the customization approach. But is the master pages actually customized using SharePoint Designer, or are they deployed using a full trust solution? And there's really no right or wrong. It all comes down on a business requirements, on a business objectives, on utilizing the platform. And that's the key point. But we need to understand the impact of the customizations. We need to understand the impact of the customizations also in long term, because the customizations in a worst case scenario can actually block certain, let's say, options in a long term roadmap. And that's not necessarily a right thing to do. As an example, you would write a still in SharePoint 2010, you would write a custom site definition, which would actually then mean that that particular deployment is locked for on-premises for years to come. It might be that the customization in the business requirements, it was stated that this deployment is designed for on-premises, but what if the CIO will be changing within a year, and the new CIO comes and starts questioning the reason why do we have the on-premises SharePoint that in first place, and why aren't we actually using, as an example, SharePoint from the Office 365. So having that flexibility there is definitely a good thing. So we wouldn't block those deployments, we wouldn't lock them in the on-premises or lock them in the cloud either. Having that flexibility of competing between the service providers or the hosting providers, is it on-prem, is it cloud, or is it which cloud, or is it Office 365, regardless where the solution is, what the solution is providing, that gives us the flexibility from a business and let's say long-term perspective. One of the things what we're hearing also quite often is that the apps pattern is for the cloud, not for the on-premises, which is kind of a, when you think of it, I mentioned the cloud application model, the CAM model a few times, and it's actually stated as a cloud application model. But to be honest, the cloud application model, it is also for on-premises, the cloud within the cloud application model, or the cloud with apps. It could be a private cloud as well. It doesn't mean that it's only within the Office 365. That's actually the point, and that's what we should be thinking when we start designing our customizations. Let's actually design, let's not think about cloud or on-premises as an exception. it's not an exception. The cloud shouldn't be an exception. Okay, this is implemented to the cloud. Therefore, I will have to implement it in a certain way. Much better approach would be, and is actually, to think about that whatever we do, we actually implement that in the right way or in the same way. Which means that let's use the same model for on-premises and cloud. Whatever customizations, whatever we do, if we use the same pattern in on-premises, which we'd use actually in the cloud, it will give us the flexibility that if the deployment is actually heading to the cloud, it will work in the cloud as well. So let's not think about the cloud as an exception. Let's think about creating a solution which will work regardless which platform it will be actually running on. And this gives us the benefit that you implement the stuff once and it actually works in the on-premises and cloud as well. And the terminology thing was the cloud application model. I mentioned this a few times. It's the CAM model. I know that some of you maybe are not that familiar on that statement yet. And it's not only for Office 365, even though the logo is actually on the top right corner. It's also for the on-premises. But the approach is that we essentially forget about the full-trust solutions, because the full-trust solutions will have a deep impact on the availability of the SharePoint farms. And full-trust solutions are full-trust. So therefore, there has to be a really strict quality assurance to ensure that the full-trust solution package doesn't deploy anything like which would compromise the availability of the farm. So therefore, the full-trust solutions are always much more complicated and much more costly to actually create, or the risks are much bigger. What's the conclusion of that one is that we actually start embracing the uncosted deployment models, which essentially means that we are actually thinking about the same model that how does the end user or the site collection owner could be deploying, as an example, master pages directly to the site collection. So we don't actually deploy our stuff using the ghosted model, which would be the stuff which is stored in the 15 hive in the file system. And this gives us actually quite a lot of flexibility, because it, even though we can pretty easily write a code which is goes through all of the site collections what we have and update the master pages in all of the site collections. And yes, it's slightly more difficult than just deploying a new version of the full-trust solution. But the whole point is that we're able to do updating. If you use the CAM approach, we're able to update the master pages, page layouts, and so forth, without actually causing service breaks, because service breaks are really expensive, because you need to communicate that, and then it causes, there's the impact for end-user perception that, damn it, again, the intranet is down because they're doing some maintenance. Well, we were just providing you the latest version of the master page, but the perception of the end-user might be something different. The whole point of the CAM application model, well, the SharePoint app model, is that the fact that they run code outside of the SharePoint context. And we can do really, really interesting stuff using the CAM patterns. We are not as restricted as actually many people are thinking with the CAM approach. We can use the CAM approach for deploying master pages or creating sites or creating templates or creating whatever in the host web or in the site collections. So it's much more, let's say, flexible than quite often understood. And there will be a lot of guidance and examples released slightly later on all of these examples. The whole point of the CAM and the SharePoint app is that it's much, much, much more than the app marketplace. Obviously, we want to have apps written to the marketplace as well, and that's definitely an awesome opportunity for the developers to actually gain visibility and provide their solution across all of the SharePoint deployments in the world. But the CAM model is not just for the app marketplace. We can actually use the same pattern without internet connectivity in the on-premises deployments to kind of increase the availability of the SharePoint farm and ensuring that we don't actually need to do service breaks when we deploy stuff, ensuring that we're able to still, for example, deploy new web templates or web template-ish approach. We can achieve many of the same objectives with cloud application model than compared to the old full resolution patterns, but the end result will be the same. The approach might be slightly different. So we might not be using actually feature framework because that's more a classic old school way of doing stuff. But we might be still providing actually similar templating model as the web template as an example. And there's good examples, for example, in my own blog related on remote provisioning and how we can introduce or create a similar end result as site definitions and web templates, but using the cloud application pattern. There's an example downloadable as well. And the key point of this one, I mentioned a few times, that this pattern is also for on-premises, not only for Office 365. And that's really interesting because we can increase the availability of the on-premises farm using the CAM pattern. And then if we implement our stuff using the CAM pattern, it can be seamlessly migrated to the cloud without impacting the customization, what the end user are actually feeling. So let's actually think about, so what I've mentioned this a few times, but the challenge when you think of it is that quite often people uses these nice hype terms like evergreen and evergreen, and we are following on the release cycle of SharePoint 2013 or SharePoint in general. The key challenge, if we think about this old model, is that whenever we are crossing a major version, we will have a bigger upgrade project. Because we need to ensure that our code, which is tightly coupled in a SharePoint, will work across the following version. So every single time there is a newer version available for SharePoint, there will be a specific upgrade project, which will have its specific costs. Although, say, during the version, there will be a smaller updates and maintenance breaks and maintenance done for the customizations. But anyway, the customization have to be upgraded to get access on the new capabilities within the product. Like with SharePoint 2013, you can run your SharePoint 2010 code natively in the SharePoint 2013, but you can't actually, you need to upgrade the code to gain access on the new fancy functionalities of SharePoint 2013. And this means that it will cause additional costs during each release cycle of the customization. The customizations will cause downtime, mentioned numerous times, each time when we actually do some changes within the customizations. And that means that we need to ensure that we minimize the customizations or the impact, which means that there will be a complex application lifecycle process required to let's say, ensure the high quality of the code. And this is the old model, and this is something what many of the enterprise customers, well, bigger and smaller customers, are saying that it's unbearable. We need to change that. We can't keep on doing the same stuff across all of the versions. The economical situation in the across businesses is such that it's not anymore justifiable. You can't justify an upgrade project in every single second year. At the same time, however, you need to be able to introduce new capabilities to your intranet in a more frequent manner. So we need to find this alternative solution to introduce new capabilities without impacting this release cycle within a SharePoint. And that's what the cloud application model and the new model is all about. So we actually have this loosely coupled SharePoint customizations running somewhere outside of the SharePoint. Indeed, some of that might have a deep impact on a SharePoint versioning, but in general, in high level or in maturity of the SharePoint app, customizations are actually running outside of the SharePoint context, and therefore we can actually upgrade the SharePoint without impacting any of the customizations. And while we upgrade the SharePoint, the app most likely, I'm using birds should and most likely I know, but we will have the backward capable compatibility APIs to move across the versions. You can't most likely jump across multiple versions, but you can actually upgrade the SharePoint to a following version, and the REST APIs, the client-side OM, will still work, like it actually did work in 2010 and when we moved to 2013. You were not forced to do any changes. The same backward compatibility model will be there for the SharePoint apps and the CAM pattern. So the customizations as such don't block new capabilities of SharePoint, and that's the key and most important thing. So the customizations will utilize the services from SharePoint and other services, but they won't break and they won't block access on the new and shiny things. And that's where the beef is. So we're able to provide new capabilities within a SharePoint without, again, rewriting of the customizations. And this will be then beneficial not only for customers and partners and Microsoft, but it's everybody will win whenever this model actually works properly. And I know, I've been through the same thing personally, that I first time when the whole model was introduced to me, I was like, yeah, not going to happen. I will keep on doing whatever the old model was doing. So the denial is definitely the first step. But this is part of our product roadmap. So the product roadmap is really clear. And it relates also on the fact that Microsoft is really committed on the cloud services, and we cannot provide a full-trust solution customizations from the cloud. Therefore, the whole customization pattern will be changed to minimize the impact on a SharePoint. So that makes a lot of sense. And this is definitely something new, which is always a challenging thing to learn. But as an IT person, we need to learn every single time. We need to keep up with the change, which might be, let's say, tiring, but at the same time, when you actually started using SharePoint, you probably still remember when the feature framework and solution structures were introduced for you. Those XMLs probably didn't make any sense at the time, but nowadays you might have catched on. So this is a big transition. We are crossing a huge, this is a massive transition between the customization pattern. So it will take a while to actually adapt. A really good example is also the camel. If you were ever forced to actually learn how the list schemas are actually created without any wizards and without any things. There might be people, not all of you have probably even seen how the solution packages and manifest files and all of that was created using DDF files before there was any tools in the Visual Studio. So we come to a lot of this pain, which is now kind of taken away from the new developers, which is kind of unfair for the people who've gone through the pain. But at the same time, it actually gives the benefit that all of the new persons or all of the people who are familiar of a general web development can actually now start developing SharePoint. So there won't be any kind of a big hurdles to understand feature framework XMLs or other complex scenarios whenever we start using the cloud application model, which is a major and massive deal for many of the developers out there looking for SharePoint, but they're scared even to jump on board because it really doesn't make any sense. And to be honest, I can kind of relate. You can probably relate too if you know the feature framework and the complexity of the feature framework and solution packages. And how long does it actually have taken for you to master them? So what it means is that we essentially, as part of the SharePoint 2013, we're kind of redefining the application models. So the classic full-trust solutions, they're completely supported, they will be still there. But we should consider them more as an ISV solution, more as a platform-level customization, something which we don't necessarily start writing by default for all of our customers and deployments. More from a custom service applications. Well, you should avoid custom service applications anyway. Custom WCF services. But it's kind of a full-trust solutions are more platform-level customizations. So when we actually then start introducing customer-specific customizations, we can actually do that using the client-side solutions or SharePoint apps. And in my thinking, this has been divided to two different sections because the one side of this, of the cloud application model, is actually the massively enhanced JavaScript APIs in SharePoint 2013. So you don't always need to have a server-side code because you can actually replace the server-side code by placing JavaScript on a page layout or master page just as well. Why do you actually need to write code to, let's say, a query a cross-site collections to get some information across using the server-side code and using the whatever querying API? If you can actually achieve the same end result using JavaScript and the client-side technologies with the JavaScript placed on a master page or to the page layouts, wouldn't that be a suitable solution? And I completely understand, I've been through the same pain, is that the understanding of the new approach is always challenging. The second point on the client-side solution is the remote provisioning for elements, which essentially means that, yeah, let's not use even feature framework or sandbox solutions to deploy our master pages or page layouts or whatever. We can actually push them using the app pattern. And there's a nice blog entry with the demo and example code in my blog post as well. So, and using the remote provisioning will essentially mean that we're embracing the unghosted model. The master pages, page layouts, images, whatever we have, they don't go to the 15 hive. They are actually in a database. And that will actually have a massively positive impact from our disaster recovery perspective as well. Because in old school, you always needed to have the customizations and the database in the same level. But now, when all of the customizations are actually in a database, as long as you give me the database, I can restore that. There's no dependencies on anything else, which is a pretty, pretty cool thing. The SharePoint app dimension with provider-hosted apps to provide new capabilities clients for the client-side solution, so it doesn't have to be, again, marketplace app. And we can definitely do whatever customer-specific customizations within this the middle approach as well. Then we do have the SharePoint app based on the marketplace, and that's an awesome scenario for packaging reusable solutions for specific functionalities, and then we can sell that. Or as an end user, we can take really using a minimal amount of money, we can actually gain a lot of additional functionalities to our SharePoint using the marketplace and getting access on advanced capabilities. So does it mean that the Fortress solutions should not be created? Well, it's an awesome question, and we get this all the time. But the answer is actually no. It means that we should start and consider the client-side technologies whenever possible, and use the classic models as secondary option when needed. That kind of makes sense, doesn't it? If you can make your customizations in a way that it will be running in every single deployment in the world, including the cloud, that would be probably beneficial for your customizations. If, however, you do have a solution or a deployment like the internet-facing sites, you're writing a .com service, and you need to have something really highly branded, really precise for your anonymous users provided using certain UI, then the SharePoint app pattern is not for you. And the kind of a classical approach would be probably the solution to take. Well, the SharePoint app pattern could be used, but there are certain, you need to always consider which direction to actually take. The whole point of this all is that the CAM or the apps, the SharePoint apps, is another tool for use to choose from. So use the right tool for right purpose to match the requirements, and understanding those tools, understanding the scenarios where we can actually use the tool is a really important thing. And we need to always choose the tool by evaluating the tool impact in a short and a long term. So we understand that if we now use the Fortress solution path, that impact will be following. If we, however, use the CAM path or the SharePoint app approach, then we can actually do following up and so forth. So we really need to understand, because to be honest, quite often the customers who are requesting these customizations don't necessarily understand the long-term impact. If you are a customer, you might want to ask, is there any restricting impact for the chosen customization pattern in the long term? Because we want to make sure that we have still this flexibility of introducing new capabilities in the future as well, or we can actually upgrade as easily as possible. So let's actually wrap up and kind of go through what we went through. I didn't do any demos. I know that that might be a disappointment from somebody, but I think this is a really important and valuable discussion related on the SharePoint app model and where should it be used and where shouldn't it be used, or what's the high-level approach? Because there's quite a lot of discussion in the community related on the SharePoint app pattern. And it's never black and white. The whole point is that everything is well, it's never black and white, it's shades of gray. You need to evaluate options, and it's a really old joke, but everything depends. Everything depends on a business requirements, everything depends in a short and a long-term objectives, which obviously brings possibilities for the consultants to have that long discussion with and drinking some coffee with customers to evaluate those options. But it's definitely a really important thing to understand those options and the impact. So is the app model the future of SharePoint? Yes, it will be, and it is. It's the future of SharePoint, and we will be gradually moving away from the classic feature framework and solution package model. How fast? Well, that's a different thing, because currently there are certain limitations within the CAM pattern. Whenever those limitations will be addressed, And if the situation is such that you can actually achieve the same end result using the app pattern or the cloud application model compared to the classic feature framework, there's no reason why not to use a CAM pattern. We are gradually moving forward with the versions which will be released. Does it mean now that the SharePoint is no longer a development platform? Well, no. It doesn't mean that. This actually opens up a numerous new models, and it's actually much more, the CAM pattern is much more flexible than the old approach. You can still use the old approach. You can still, you're more than supported to write server-side code, but then you need to understand the impact of that. If you write the CAM pattern, you are actually essentially, you have the flexibility of writing whatever code you want using server-side in a provider-hosted application, using IIS as your host, using writing ASP.NET, using MVC. Whatever you want is on your availability. There are certain limitations due to client API limitations, but all of that will be addressed, and there will be more capabilities available with the client app, client API side as well. So, but how do I actually prepare? How do I actually get prepared for this? So as a developer architect, you should be starting moving towards the client-side technologies gradually within your projects. So essentially start evaluating those options, checking if you can actually achieve the same end result within your page layouts or master page with a client-side JavaScript, other than always writing a server-side code. That would be already a awesome hybrid, or it would, let's say, at least decrease the requirement of deploying a newer version if you would modify that master page JavaScript, which can be updated using the remote provisioning pattern. So investigating the client-side options and client-side technologies gradually within your project, that would be the right way of doing stuff. We can't do this at once. It's not a one night, tomorrow morning everything will be in the SharePoint app. No, that's never going to happen. It's a gradual, step-by-step process. Whenever we get the guidance better, whenever we get the scenario-based guidance better, and all of those things will be available on the internet, I think then people will start using more and more the SharePoint app pattern. For a customer or end user, you can actually achieve pretty much the same stuff. For example, the deployment of artifacts, the master pages, page layouts, and so forth. You can and let's say site columns and all of those things. You can actually achieve the pretty much the same stuff using the SharePoint app. So you don't, from an end user perspective, this is not necessarily even visible. Except the fact that from an end user perspective, you might want to think that do we always need to customize that much? Is this something what I need to ask to be customized from my ISV or the SharePoint provider? But that's it. That's all we can actually talk about within this presentation. And hopefully that was a beneficial. It's not a, these things are never black and white. And that's the reason why we cannot actually say that go there. If your situation is A, go to B. Because that's not really that simple. But you as an architect, or if you are a decision maker within the designing the right pattern or for customizations or the deployment customization pattern or whatever, if you are in the role of making decisions related on SharePoint, it's really good to evaluate these options and understand why the SharePoint app model has been introduced and what does it actually bring. It brings us agility. does it actually fulfill your business requirements? That might be the case that it's not. Then maybe the old pattern still might be suitable. Or can we evaluate those business requirements and rethink what has to be done? And that's probably the key learning. But that's all we can actually go through. So thanks for your time, and hopefully that was useful.